So in this video, we are going to talk about something called long short-term memory, LSTM, which is for modeling long-range dependencies. And the LSTM cell, you can think of it as a modified version of a recurrent neural network. So that is particularly helpful for working with longer sequences and really kind of essential to get good performance out of a recurrent neural network. So previously, we talked about other solutions to vanishing and gradient vanishing and exploding gradient problems. So long time ago, when we talked about multilayer perceptrons, we talked about using the ReLU function instead of sigmoid functions like the 10H or the logistic sigmoid, because it can help with mitigating or vanishing gradient problems. So, but even then, even if we use a ReLU function instead of sigmoid or 10H, we may find that making a multilayer perceptron deeper than one or two layers doesn't really work in practice. So if you've tried in the homework to have a multilayer perceptron like with four or five hidden layers, it still didn't work very well. And that is still because there might be problems with the vanishing gradients. So another technique that can help a little bit with that is batch normalization. So if you have batch normalization, you may find that you can have now a multilayer perceptron with maybe three or maybe even four layers, but it's not great. In the context of convolutional networks, because they are simpler, we found that having more layers might work. So we had the BGG16 network with 16 layers. But then going beyond 16 layers, even if we have batch norm, again, doesn't really help. So we had to add another trick called skip connections. And these skip connections in residual networks helped then with constructing networks more than, let's say, 30, 50, or 100 layers. So there are multiple tricks that we can use to help with the backpropagation when we might have vanishing or exploding gradient problems. But this was usually for the number of layers. Now in this recurrent neural network setup, we also have to consider the time steps, right? So the previous hidden states. So because we've seen in the previous video, there's this product that we compute, there might be another level of encountering vanishing and exploding gradient problems. So there are here three different techniques for dealing with these issues. So one is, the simplest one is a gradient clipping. So that is actually a quite widely used technique also in other contexts. So this is essentially setting a maximum or minimum cutoff value for the gradient. So for instance, we can say never have gradients greater than, let's say, 2 or smaller than 2, minus 2, and things like that. So we can cut manually the gradient so that we don't have very extreme updates. Another one is called truncated backpropagation through time. And this is just a simple technique for limiting the number of time steps during backpropagation. So when you have a long sequence, let's say you have a very long sequence, then these all go to the hidden layer, and then to the output layer, and so forth. So for forward propagation, you may use the whole sequence here. So, but then when you backpropagate for the hidden layers, you only maybe backpropagate through the last 20 time steps or so. So you don't backpropagate through the whole sequence. This is called truncated backpropagation through time, and it might work pretty well. However, an even better way for working with longer sequences is the so-called long short-term memory, which uses a memory cell for modeling long-range dependencies to avoid vanishing gradient problems. And this goes back to a paper from 1997, which was pretty influential proposing this type of memory cell. There has been another one called GRIU. I will just mention it again maybe at the end of the video, which is a simplified version of that, slightly simpler. But the LSTM is still widely used, and both LSTM and GRIU are perform approximately similarly well. There are sometimes problems where LSTMs perform better, sometimes where GRIUs perform better. So none of the two is universally always better than the other. It's just like another, let's say, hyperparameter to investigate whether we should use LSTM or GRIU cells. But nonetheless, LSTM cells, I think, are still more popular than GRIU cells. They are the most widely used RNN memory cells, I would say. And in this video, we are going to talk about these LSTM cells. And then also, Later, we will also implement this in code using PyTorch. So what I'm going to show you in this video may look super complicated. If you don't understand it fully, don't worry about it too much. I mean, here we are really in this class in general, also for this RNN lecture, just trying to get a big picture overview. This is still an introductory class. So most people find these LSTM cells very complicated. So if you don't understand it like fully, don't worry about it too much. If you want to learn about it more, yeah, you would have to probably spend more time reading these papers and maybe trying to implement it from scratch by yourself. So that might be probably taking multiple weeks or months to really get a good feeling for how that works. So you can't expect really like from an overview to be an expert immediately. So I'm trying to say, when you see the next couple of slides, don't freak out. It looks more complicated than it might really be, but also if you don't fully understand it, it's not your fault. It's a complicated topic. So here is how the LSTM cell looks like. So there are many, many things going on, and in the next couple of slides I will walk through this now step by step. So where is this, before I explain all these letters and notations, where is this LSTM cell located? So you would actually put this LSTM cell here in the center. So you would have one, you would use it for different time steps, but if we would focus, let's say, on this time step here, you would put it into the center here for, instead of having the regular hidden state or hidden layer, you would insert this LSTM here. And if you have a multi-layer RNN like that one, you would also have, or you can have, multiple LSTM cells. For instance, here you could have two LSTM cells. So how again this connects, so let me erase this. So in blue here, this is here the hidden state from the previous time step. So if you consider this one, this is here this input. So if we think of this whole thing as this red box here, on the left lower side, this blue is resembling the input from the previous state. Then there's something new we have, that's the cell state. I will explain it in the next couple of slides. So there's a cell state. And then here, this green one, I should have probably used for the cell state something else. Let's do it in black. So cell state. And then here in green, that, oops. Yeah, see, I will have explanations. So here, this in green one, this will be the output to the next time step. And then here in pink or purple will be the output to the next hidden layer. So you can see this red one really would fit here into this RNN. So instead of having just a regular hidden layer, we would now have this LSTM memory cell. So going through things step by step, we have this cell state at a previous time step, and then we update here in this whole computation the cell state and pass it on to the next time step. So there's this so-called state of the LSTM. And another thing we have is, like I said before, we have the activation from the previous time step, so the hidden state from the previous time step, and we will pass on the activation computed from this memory cell to the next time step. Then here for the cell state, we have two different operations. So we have here the element wise multiplication. Here we have an addition, and these sigmas here, they represent logistic sigmoid activation functions. Now here we so there are three different gates. So talking now about the gates. So we have this forget gate here. So it controls essentially which information is remembered and which one is forgotten, and it can reset the cell state. So here we receive the input at the current time step, and we receive the input from the previous hidden state, like in a regular RNN layer, and then it goes through some computation here. And this one, this computation is essentially involving two matrices like we had before. So we have, before we had this matrix H H, right, and W, H, X. Here we are calling it for forget gate instead of HH, let's call it FH and FX. And then we have also bias unit BF. So I just see I have it actually here. And this goes through a sigmoid unit. And you know that in a sigmoid, the output can be either or is between 0 and 1. So if the output is 0, for instance, and there's a multiplication here, element wise multiplication, we can essentially erase the previous cell state. So here at this time step, the network has the option to forget the cell state. So in terms of not doing anything from the previous, so not including any information from the previous time step. Or it could learn a 1, so it could fully use the information from the previous time step. So this is the so-called forget gate, so which it's controlling which information is remembered and which is forgotten, so it can zero out the previous cell state. So then there is this input gate. So here, the forget gate again is potentially erasing information. And here in the input gate, we are adding now information. So there are actually two things going on. There's a sigmoid and a 10H here. There's an input node and an input gate, and they get element-wise multiplied. And so this one can be 0 or 1, and this one can be between minus 1 and 1. And the output then can essentially also be between 0 and between minus 1 and 1. And this gets added to the previous cell state, which might be erased through the forget gate or kept. And each of those, they are really just computed like in a regular neural network where we have, so here we have a plus, of course, so here we have W times X, and here we have this one. Actually, I know that that should, I think it's correct, sorry. Okay, so this is our setup here. So that's how we compute this. And then the same thing for the input gate, we have a logistic sigmoid instead of a 10H now. And these are the values we compute, we multiply them and then add them to the cell state. And yeah, this information comes also, of course, from the previous cell state and the input here. Now, just looking at everything together, how we compute the output cell state for the next time step. So again, just to summarize, we multiply the previous cell state by this forget gate. Then we add the product of the input node and the input gate. And then we also have a third gate, that's the output gate, that's for updating the values of the hidden units. So here, before what we had, this is just for the cell state, but now the cell state here also goes through a 10H and then gets multiplied. So this can be again between minus 1 and 1, and this gets multiplied with this output gate here. So the output gate itself is also computed like the previous ones, and the product of this 10H output and this output gate goes then to the next time step and then also to the next layer in the neural network. So with that, I mean, if I go back, it goes here. So it goes either here and here if we talk about this red one. So this would be to the next layer here. And this one would be to the next hidden state. Okay, let's go forward again. All right, so this is what we had. So that's the output gate. And yeah, here is how the next hidden state is computed. That's what I just mentioned, the output gate times the 10H, or the cell state. And yeah, this is essentially it. And it's a pretty complicated setup. There's kind of some justification behind it, so that's embedded in the original paper if you're interested in reading about that. So in practice, if I mean, this sounds very obscure. I think, I mean, it works well in practice. So that's probably why it stood the test of time, why people use it. And yeah, like I said, it's still widely used and popular. But there's also a version where people try to simplify it a little bit. So there's this gated recurrent unit, which is, I mean, it's not that recent. It's also already 7 years old. So it's not that new anymore, not that recent anymore. But it's also a popular implementation of something similar that is a little bit simpler. It has fewer parameters. And in practice, yeah, both, like I mentioned before, may work well in practice. Because of time reasons, we're not going to cover the gated recurrent unit. It's also not, I would say, super interesting in that way, just to talk about it in the same way we talked about it before. So here's just a snapshot of it. And if you're interested, there's a nice article exploring both LSTMs and comparing them to Jira use if you would like to read more about these types of architectures and get a feeling when they work well and looking at some applications of those. All right, so again, here in this lecture, we are just trying to get a big picture of how recurrent networks work. There are many other topics we wanted to cover, so we are not going into too much detail about this particular architecture. If you're interested, I will post some more reading resources on Piazza, on Canvas. So in the next video, I will then talk about many-to-one RNNs on a word level for implementing a classifier. So that will be our example. And then later, in a later week, in 2 weeks approximately, we will be revisiting also recurrent neural networks for many-to-many tasks for generating new text.